My title can be What is Love? First possibility, or The Arena of the Two? Second possibility. We can start with a statement, a famous statement of Lacan. I quote, love comes to compensate for the lack of a sexual connection. Love comes to compensate for the lack of a sexual connection. So love is not a connection, a relation, a rapport in the field of sexuality. Love is a supplement, which is just at the point where a sexual connection is missing. So our problem is composed of three terms: connection, which inexists, lack, which is the constatation of this inexistence of sexual connection, and supplement, which properly is love. Naturally, you can have the preliminary question, but what is finally this famous Lacanian inexistence of the sexual connection? I take a metaphor for a very small answer to this question. Suppose the world is composed of natural numbers only. 1, 2, 3, 4, and so on. Suppose we name connection of the two numbers, the division of the first by the second. For example, we take for connection the symbol you have at the beginning of the paper, okay? We can say the connection between 4 and 2 is, by definition, the division of 4 by 2, and so is 2. It's not, for the moment, too difficult mathematically. So you can see that in this particular case, the connection exists because the result is also a natural number. And so the result is in the world, if the world is composed of exclusively natural numbers. But very often, it's not the case. For example, the connection of 7 and 3 is the division of 7 by 3, but the division of 7 by 3 is not, as you can understand, a natural number. So, from the point of view of the world, the connection between 7 and 3 does not exist. So, we can say something like that. In the world of, or the name of the world, in the world of desire, in the world of sexuation, in the world of sexual existence, and so on, there is no sexual connection in this sense. That is, the connection between two terms is not a term of the world which is considered. We can say something like that, maybe a connection of two desires is not a desire. That is the first point concerning the axiom of Lacan, the sexual inexistence of a connection. But we can first stipulate that if the sexual connection inexists by an effect of structure, like that sort of inexistence. Love as a supplement cannot exist in the same structure. So love as a supplement to the lack of sexual connection can only come to be by chance. So we have an opposition between sexual structure and the chance of love. So the sexual belongs to the order of being, or nature, and love belongs to the order of the event. Lacan says that in his own way when he writes that love is an approach or a boarding. I quote Lacan, "It is love that comes to board being in the encounter. It is love that comes to board being in the encounter. The encounter is effectively the name for the randomness of love, for its invental dimension. And it's at random that the supplement of the lack of connection is initiated. Of course, the encounter between two sexual positions is guided, oriented by the obscure object of desire that each member of a couple finds in the other. But love, as love, goes directly to the complete individual who, as a total being, mysteriously supports the object of desire. This difference between an object as a cause for the desire and a being, a complete being, as a polarity of love is the difference between, on one side, the impossibility of sexual connection, and on the other side, the possibility of a love construction. The second is the supplement of the first. With respect to sexual difference, which is essentially disjunctive, love, in subsuming the object as the being of the individual, love is boarding of being, constructs what I name a sort of arena for a presentation in which the non-connection is effected as a count, the count for two. Love is this arena of the presentation of the two. In the consequences of an encounter, we find this possibility of a two that is neither counted for one, nor the sum of one plus one. A two counted for two immanently. A two which is neither fusion in the one, nor summation, one plus one, and in which, consequently, the two is in excess of what composes eight, without for as much annexing the three to eight. Finally, a real two. The production of love is a real two, immanent. We have here, I say in passing, the particular form, the love form, if you want, of two speculative theorems of philosophy. Theorem one, when there is an inexistence or a lack, only an excess can come as a supplement. So it's not a term which is a supplement of a lack, but always an excess. So love is by itself excessive. And theorem two, it is the event that constructs for a situation of being the truth of that situation. For the case that concerns us today, this can be expressed. It is love that produces the truth that sex is capable of, and not the inverse. So love is the truth of sex, and not, as it is the case, the pessimistic French moralist, the sex which is the truth of love. To think this form, to think this truth, is the philosophical task, and I do a fragment of this task before you this night. Begin at the beginning, the non-connection, the non-sexual connection, this love is a supplement of this lack. As we can see the paper, we note like that the supposed connection, the supposed sexual connection. We write W, the feminine position, W for woman, it's not mysterious. You note M, the masculine position, and if it does not exist complete sexual connection, we must simply write that we have neither this formula nor this formula. So we express here that there is no direct sexual connection between woman position and man position. I speak of a position. Naturally, it's not the empirical situation of any individuals. We have two different positions, and I name woman and man by pure commodity. We can find other name if you want, and naturally, the sexual disconnection and finally the construction of love don't suppose that the two different positions are the position empirically of a man and a woman. It could be a woman and a woman, a man and a man, and maybe a man with some other thing that I don't know. So, as we can see in the part B of the paper, Axiom of Sexuation, this formula, we have not M in connection to W and not connection of W, not before, is the first axiom of sexuation, is properly the axiom of non-connection. Nevertheless, after that, there is several ways to conceive the non-connection of the feminine position and the masculine position of, if you want, of the two different positions. The crucial point is to conceive the sexual non-connection with reference to an exact appreciation of its disjunctive character. We can conceive first of the non-connection as an integral disjunction, a complete disjunction or complete separation, in the sense of the curse of Sodom and Gomorrah. The two sexes die each on their own side. This means, in that case, that there is absolutely no term common to the position M and the position W. Between the two positions, we cannot find something like a mediation. Or, other manner to say that, what it's in a common connection to these two terms is empty. So we have this as axiom of sexual nihilism, I can say something like that, not only the non-sexual connection, but completely disjunctive form, and so sexual nihilism, if something is connected to the masculine position. And if the same thing is connected to the feminine position, we have by necessity that the thing in question is void. This is the expression of the fact that there is absolutely nothing in common between the masculine position and the feminine position. Because we suppose that if something is really in connection to the two, it's a zero, it's void. I inscribe in the paper this formula as the axiom of sexual nihilism in position C of the page. And we can call this position a segregative position. It is segregative in its empirical consequences because each of the sexed positions have finally in society functions and places that inscribe this pure disjunction. But I do not believe that we can, without having recourse to some imaginary reference to the feminine mystery, hold for real that the non-connection is pure disjunction. It's not my position. I don't assume here that non-connection is complete disjunction. So we will assume that there is at least one positive term which is connected with the two sexed positions. We will write this term, the supposed local mediation of the global non-connection, with the letter U. This letter U connotes both ubiquity and universality. And maybe also in French, un. But in English, it's one. So the letter is a failure. But ubiquity, universality, and un. We will then have the formula that declares the existence of U. It's the second axiom of sexuation that you have in the paper. U exists, which is first connected to the position woman, second connected to the position man, and third different of the void, which is not zero. So it's a positive term which is inside the two positions, and so they are not in direct connection, but they have a common term. Must we think this common term, the only object term to be inserted equivocally within the non-connection, or is there, in addition to this term, U, a quantity of other common predicates which can be activated at any encounter of something of the position man and something of the position woman? That is a great question. We are now exposed to the contrary of the segregative position. That is the position, what I call the humanist position, which is that the two positions, man and woman, share, besides the object you, a multitude of predicative terms, allowing us to detail almost to infinity their common attachment to humanity. This position, in reality, at the end, denies the non-connection and sustains that a detailed description of what the two terms have in common realizes a sort of approximation of a connection. Certainly, there is an element that forms a relation of two unrelated terms within the space of non-connection. And I posit this term under the letter U. But I think that this element is absolutely undetermined, undescribable, uncomposable. It is, in fact, atomic, in the sense that nothing can be described into its composition. It's something like a pure point. It's something like an atomic determination without descriptive multiplicity. If you want, the two positions are something in common, but that something in common is strictly minimal. It's something like a pure and decomposable object which attests by its presence the possibility of desire, the possibility of something in common, but which does not reduce the fundamental non-connection. So this you, the term you, is made up of nothing and can be the object of no analytic description. In other words, it's true that something exists that entertains a relation with a two-sexed position. Okay. But we will say of this term that nothing enters into relation with it except the void. This can be written, and it is the third axiom of sexuation in the paper. If something is connected with you, this something is void. So you is a pure atom, which is related to woman and related to man, but with which nothing is related. And it is why it's a pure minimal point inside the non-connection. This fundamental axiom, which is the atomicity of you, indicates that the sexed positions are such that you intersects both of them, but you itself remains uncomposed, undetermined, because only the void enters into relation with it. A third way to conceive the non-connection, according to a disposition which goes back at least as far as Aristophanes meet in Plato's Symposium, is that the sexed positions are both totally disjoined and complementary. This means that their reunion or their summation reconstitutes humanity as integral. The two positions are no longer in relation, but they have this mediate connection that their supposed conjunction is the equivalent of all, or of the integral one. This position could be written position man plus position of woman equals one if one is the symbol for totality, as opposition to zero, which is a symbol of the void. So it's not a direct connection between the two positions, but it's something like a mediate connection, because finally we can reconstitute the totality by juxtaposition of the two positions. I don't believe that there is some real in this equation, in fact. The sexual difference cannot be totalized. There certainly exist sexual positions which are not immediately reducible neither to the masculine position nor to the feminine. It's a complex question of different genders, as you know. But the point which interests us immediately is that we cannot posit that the two sexual positions, masculine and feminine, can be totalized in the one to constitute the totality. So we posit that no totality is a result of a pairing off of the two positions. And that is the fourth axiom of sexuation in the paper, the axiom of non-totality. And we can now recapitulate what we can call the elementary axioms of the sexual disconnection or of the sexuation as such. So the part B of the paper. Incompatibility of the two positions, disconnection of the two positions. We have not M connected to W, and we have not W connected to M. Existence of a common term, which is also refutation of the completely disjunctive position, the segregative position. You exist, which is connected to the woman position, connected to the masculine position, and not identical to zero, to the void. Atomicity of the common term. If another term is connected to you, this other term is null, is zero. And non-totalization of the two positions, masculine position plus feminine position does not equal the totality in the sexual world. We must, in passing, and it's a very interesting problem, look at the derivation that leads from the real position, which is inscribed in the four axioms, to the segregative position. I think there is a movement which sometimes is repeated, sometimes today, which goes from the true position to the segregative position. This movement is made, in fact, of a dual process. On the one hand, the common term U is excised from its feminine inclusion. It can be a real excision, because the vaginal excision, if you want, is in fact the material execution of the excision of you, that is, of the common term between the feminine position and the masculine position. And it is an activation of the disjunctive position. So this excision of you can be expressed thus. A woman contains nothing that ordains her for the public space. Because U, as humanity, is the term inside the feminine position, which expresses the appartenance of the feminine position to humanity and to public space. If you excise the U, you can say that a woman contains nothing that ordains her for the public space. Or, a woman is essentially a private creature. On the other hand, and it's the second process, since no other atomic thing ties a woman to a man, there is complete disconnection. And so, there is no masculine knowledge of the space occupied by a woman. No possibility for a man to understand what is the space occupied by a woman, which is not the public space by excision of you, but which becomes a space which is entirely obscure for the man. And so, we have the supposition of a potentially infinite dilatation of the feminine without the obstacle of something atomic, which gives us the supposition which could very well, since a woman has no atom, be finally equivalent to the wall. I inscribe this directly, as you can see, in D of the paper, traditional vision of the feminine position. First, you transform the feminine position by subtraction of U, which is material or symbolic excision. So we pass from W to W minus U, which is excision. But excision is also the possibility of dilatation, because there is no obstacle by a closed term. And so maybe a woman is the same thing as the whole. And it is why we have the possibility that a woman is both a destitute being, because she has not public value, and an emphatically over-evaluated being, because it's possible that she is infinite. And that is the complete disposition of traditional vision of the woman, which is the derivation of the four axioms by excision of you of the feminine position. And it is why it's the same disposition which affirms first that woman has no place in the public disposition, that a woman is a private creature and so on, and that there exists a mysterious feminine elevation. So the cult of the feminine is the same as the reduction of the feminine. There is no distinction between the feminine as a sacred place and the feminine as a purely private place. It's the same movement. Completely different are our four axioms of sexuation, naturally. First, they say that the feminine position W contains the universal element U, which is sexual, but without any determination. Second, they say that W is absolutely different from the masculine position, but it's neither complementarity nor an infinite expansion to all the space. And it's in this context that we can propose a formal understanding of law. I give you a first definition. The key point is that love activates the term you in two different directions. we can say that love is something like an event, naturally, an encounter, and this encounter activates the term you, the common term you, but it activates this term in two different directions. So, that is my definition, my first definition. A love encounter is what attributes eventually a dual function to the atomic and unanalyzable intersection of two succeeded positions. The function of the object, the first function of the object, by which a desire finds its cause, and the function of a point from which the two produces its unity in the form of a process of investigation of the world from the point of view of the two. So you see, I propose in this definition to say that, okay, there is eventual signification of love, there is encounter as an event, but this event is in the context of the four axioms of sexuation. So the effect of the encounter is to activate what is in common between the two succeeded positions. But this activation is in two completely different directions. On one side, it's the sexual determination of you, and you is the common object of desire. And so it's realized the possibility of one position to recognize in the other the support of the object of desire, and reciprocally. But finally, we have to understand that it's the same object. But it's another question. The common object of desire. This is it's the first function of you. But there is another function, completely different, which is that you is the point of departure of a process which is in direction of outside, in the world itself, of a process of, in the world, from the point of view of the two, the affirmation of the two in the world. And that is, these two functions of the atomic term you exist because the connection of you to the two succeeded positions, woman and man, can be read in two ways. That is the most important point. We can interpret that you is the common term of the two positions in two different ways. First way, we understand you from the point of view of the non-connection of the two positions. So the atomic you is only what circulates in the non-connection. If you want, it's the expression and also the limit of the non-connection. So the two positions, woman and man, are in this interpretation only submitted to a misunderstanding concerning the term. Misunderstanding because the term is interpreted as a common term, but from the point of view of two positions which are disconnected. And so the interpretation of the common term cannot be the same. And so we have a misunderstanding between two forms of desire and a misunderstanding concerning the term you itself, the same term, which is cause of their common desire. And a misunderstanding that nothing expressible in words can dissolve because you cannot be analyzed precisely, because it is atomic. So we can speak of you, the misunderstanding continues because there is finally nothing to say concerning you, apart the fact that there is a misunderstanding concerning the common object of two completely different desires. That is the first reading, which is sexual, or more generally, which is intimate, the intimate part of love, the part which concerns exclusively the two positions. But there is another interpretation. We can read all that in the other sense. Starting with you, which is the common object, we construct a pairing of the two positions, something which envelops the two positions. To do that, we have to suppress you, in fact, because you is a permanent cause of misunderstanding. So we have to produce, and is in fact very important in love, an internal excision, but an excision of you in the two positions, and not, like in the segregative practice, an excision of you uniquely in the feminine position. So we have to, the point of departure is you, but we consider the two positions without you, precisely. So to understand that, you have to consider the diagram on the other side of the paper. I read with you the diagram. You have the two positions, which are, in fact, in concrete situation, two representative of the two positions. And we have you as the common term. So it's an interpretation in set theory, if you want. In fact, connection here is inclusion. So you is included in woman and in man and in the common part. So we have a connection by you exclusively. For the rest, which for what is not you, as you can see, W and M are completely non-connected. They are connected only by you. Okay, it's the first situation. And if we resume the diagram to this part, we have the intimate situation of the sexual situation. If you want, it's the central universe of love that is something like bed, in fact. You know, it's the sexual or the intimate part of the connection of the two. The misunderstanding, the active misunderstanding concerning immediately the common object of desire. But we have also, with you as a center, but a center which is a suppressed center, the construction of possible envelopes of the two positions without, if you want, their obscure common term, but the unity of which is precisely that they envelop in the world, in the real existence of the world, simultaneously the two positions. And it was the position of T1, T2, and so on, Tn is a possible expansion without limit, in fact. And in that sort of envelopes, you have something which is connected to masculine position and something which is connected to W at the in the world, at the exterior of the two terms, and which is without the common term. So we have a logic not of contraction on the common term, but a logic of expansion in the world, which is possible because the common term exists, but which not reproduces the misunderstanding concerning you, because in that sort of practice, you is excision, because there is a difference between the world as such and the bed as such. Okay. So that is the interpretation of the movement. Now, we can also say if you see the diagram, that conceived as a supplementary process, love is always disposed between two boundaries. On the one side, there is a kind that reduced to the misunderstanding about the object, result in the central phenomenon, it can be called only a sexual adventure. If you take only the central part of the diagram, you have a first boundary of love, which is a sexual adventure. It can go along quite well, but it's not constructs an arena for the two. So it's only the misunderstanding as such, which can be a quiet misunderstanding. Okay. It's the first boundary. And it is only the activation of the structure. A sexual adventure is an activation, a local activation of the structure. But at the other extremity, we have the kind that, assuming nothing but the two, and not only the central part, with no partition of the object, no excision of the object, we have the kind that be called sublime or platonic love. Because we have only the infinite expansion in the world without the misunderstanding, and so without the central and intimate part of love. And sublime or platonic love proposes imaginarily that disconnection itself or the sexual mystery as such can be singularized as a pure encounter. It is in my conviction of the essence of love to be neither trivial nor sublime. This is why, as each one knows, it belongs to the order of labor. This labor is the complex becoming of the two functions of the term you. Love cannot avoid the sexual non-connection under the modality of a misunderstanding touching the object. And this object, by the strength of desire, assures an imaginary triumph of the one, because the misunderstanding is always under the imaginary representation of a fusion. Love can only construct the two towards the outside and not as such toward the object inside. The movement which of love inside itself is finally the intimate. That is the misunderstanding, the sexual misunderstanding concerning sex as such. So love cannot construct the two properly inside, but only outside. And love is then the alternative movement of an external expansion of the two, which constructs an arena for the two, and a return to the atomic object, which dilates the two as such, but preserves the virtual outline of its expansion. Alors, it's a diastole and systole. It is why, finally, love is really as hurt. <It's>, expansion and construction, always. Empirically, the external expansion of the two is the innumerable practices in common of the two lovers. Shared investigation of the world, without which love has no arena of its own, except when it is a sexual adventure. And logically, the two begins to exist, starting from the central atom, from you, and is it possible after that to identify what envelops these two as such, exception made precisely of the term, you? This gives us the terms of the situation that envelop the subtraction or the common excision of you on the side of man as well as on the side of woman, and we can call such a term which envelop the pure position without the common part, woman, pure woman, man, pure man, without the obscure common object, it envelops the two forms in something which is a part of the world, but a part of the world which is seen and experimented from the point of view of the two. If we call this term T1, T2, and so on, we have what is, is given in the first page as the love construction that we can interpret. A new term of the word T is experimented from the point of view of love, that is, from the point of view of the construction of the two, when the excision of you in the first position is connected to this term. The excision of you of the masculine position is also correlated to this term. And this term is different from you, not in connection, in not connected to you. If you have something like that, you can say that the term T1, T2, and by expansion all the world, if it is possible, is really disposed in the experience of M. Now, the set of these terms, which are, as in the second page, in expansion, that the expansion of the universe of love, as the expansion of the universe properly, in the expansion of the universe of love, we have the construction of the virtual arena of the two, and all these terms, T1, T2, Tn, finally, at the infinite, are constructed within the duration specific to a love sequence as its non-sexual matter, as its not intimate center. Also, naturally, that sort of identification of this arena built by the subtraction of you is secretly animated through and through by, finally, this sexual determination. So it's a strong example of what we can say the causality of the absence of the term. It is because you is excised of the two positions that we can have something like a construction, a love construction, which is not completely destroyed by the misunderstanding concerning the object, the fundamental object. And so the rhythm of love, the rhythm of love can be expressed in terms of the diastole of its expansion in the world, and the systole of what leads back to the sexual atomicity of you. And the two constitute, by necessity, the movement of love. So the relationship between the two movements, expansion of in direction of the world from the point of view of the two, and contraction inside or about the common term which is the very complex relationship in the process of love between public activities and intimité, which is properly the fundamental dialectic of love, this relationship is unclear, in fact, is always unclear. And it is why there is always in the vision of lovers something which is obscure, which is surprising. It is why there is no straight way in love. There is always something which is not exactly on the two feet. We can speak of the lameness of love. And in fact, whatever of the arena of the two is dependent on desire is itself absolutely indeterminate. So the relationship between the two, between the intimate part of love and the expansive part of love, is obscure. There is an external expansion of the two correlative to the conjoined excision of the object. But when the object is once again in the efficacy of the non-connection, that part of this there is that displaces the sexual topology and turns into a radical indetermination. So that the lameness of love, considered, let us say, in bed or in the toils of sex, can also be defined as the deadlocking of the sexed position that form a couple between two indeterminate things. So the final definition of love is that love is always situated between two indeterminations. First, the internal indeterminate thing, you, which is the object, you, and the exterior indeterminate thing, which is some unpredictable fragment of other, of the arena of the two. So you have, if you take the second page, you have indetermination of you as the center and common part of the encounter, but you have also a complete indetermination of the successive fragment of the world which are sized by the expansion of love. So the process of love is toujours between U and T as two things which are finally without a clear determination. And between U and what leads back to you from a term T, subsuming the excision of U to W and to M, the distance between two indeterminations is open. And so we can propose a second definition of love. I give the first. A love is the evental establishment of a difference between the undetermined thing, the term you, that founds the lack of sexual connection, and the undetermined things that founds the excess with respect to this non-connection. In fact, if you can see the diagram, you see that the process of love, and so the systole and the diastole is always between you and some T. The movement is between you and some T. So U is the center of the systole, and T, N, or T, 1, 2, 3, T is the limit of the diastole, but there is no determination, strict determination, neither concerning you, which is an atomic term without possible description, neither concerning T in the world, because T is not predetermined by anything at all, because the relationship between T and U is finally a distance which has no precise concept. So a love is establishment of a difference between two indeterminate things, U and T. And ultimately, The two that love institutes is such, is the distance between two indeterminations. And such is the formal principle of a supplement. So we can conclude, love is the only experience of the two counted in pure reference to itself. The two which is not construct with the one. Because the one which is you or which is T are in complete indetermination. And so we have only the two, which is the distance between the two indeterminate objects. And each singular love as this as universal, that it made its own contribution to establishing that the two can be conceived from its place, from its proper place, a place that is partially subtracted from the hegemony of the one, as well as from its inclusion within the three. So, this distance between two and determination, or this movement which is a complex movement of expansion and contraction, intimacy and exteriority, the bed of the world, if you want, and, some and something like that, it's the process of love itself as the process of the two. And we cannot say that we cannot find a one which is a prescription concerning the unity of the two. So neither absolute transcendence of the one nor the Trinitarian dialectic, neither commitment from the one, neither commitment for the three, the two in its proper process. That is love. And it is from this point of view that we can see to what extent love is without any God. Without God, love affirms the immanence of the two as a possible experience. Love is without God in that the two never pre-exists with respect to its process. It is in this way as an experience in which God fails to guarantee the pre-existence of the separation, that I understand, for my part, the enigmatic sentence that the Portuguese poet Cairo pronounces, and that I am pleased to conclude with, love is a thought. Thank you.